Amici di Sportface, ben ritrovati nell'oramai consueto appuntamento 15 minuti con quest'oggi. Mi sento un po' come un bambino che per la prima volta va a Luna Park e assaggia per la prima volta lo zucchero filato. Intervista a tre quest'oggi, in mia compagnia il collega Lorenzo Andreoli. Ciao Lorenzo.
Buonasera Luca, buonasera a tutti.
E abbiamo anche un ospite internazionale, Marius Copil. Hi Marius, how are you?
Ciao, ciao ragazzi. All good, you?
After all, it's okay.
That's good.
First of all, thanks for having accepted this invite. We are honored to have you here. Unfortunately, all of us are playing the most difficult match ever. Marius, I know that you live in Bucharest. So the first question is, what's the current situation in your country with the coronavirus?
We have around 300 cases every day, so everybody is at home. If you go out, you have to complete a form to say where you go, and you can go to the supermarket and you can do a few other things, but not much. You can go running outside, but alone. You're not allowed to run with somebody else. And yeah, people are a little bit scared, but I hope this situation is going to change in a few weeks and we can start to have a normal life again.
The situation is very similar, like in Italy, also in Romania. But about 2 months ago, you have become a dad. So congratulations for this.
Thank you, thank you.
Let me ask you, what is the name of the boy and the feelings about that day and how your life has changed?
His name is Arthur, so Arturo.
Okay, see.
Arturo, yeah, it's great. He's now 2 months and almost 1 week, so it's great. I just changed the diapers now. And I came to the interview. He's good. I took part at the birth, so I was inside the room with my girlfriend, and I saw everything live. And I was super excited, and I was blessed that I had the chance to be there and to see that alive, because you can have it only maybe one time or just another. Maybe two, three times maximum to have it in your life, and I was blessed to be there.
Lorenzo, a te la
So,
parola.
Marius, this is a very strange moment in our life. For you, how about the situation on tour?
For me, I think right now with my situation, it came at a very good moment, because I
Okay.
became a father. I get to spend time with my son at home. I can see him grow a little bit, so I'm not going to the tournaments. I'm, you don't go to practice 6, 7 hours, so you don't see the kid at all. So for me right now, it came in a very good moment. And anyway, I was not playing good in the last end of the season, the beginning of the season. I didn't play so well, so my confidence was not great. So it came at the perfect timing for me. I cannot complain about this. But for the fans, for everybody who is involved in tennis, and all the sponsors and so on, I don't think it's great for now. But I mean, it's in all the world. This situation is not only in tennis. So we hope that we're gonna finish with this virus, and we're gonna enjoy again our life, and then I can come to Italy. I really love it
Fantastic.
there.
And we can go on about the tour. Your career, you won three Challenger title. And which one left you the best memory?
Oh, that's a good one. I think the one in Russia that I won,
Kazan.
Kazan. I went there with my fitness coach, and I checked the weather in Moscow only. I didn't check in Kazan how it was, and I saw in Moscow was like -1, -2. So I took, just some small clothes, not very for winter, like, not a jacket. I just had like a spring jacket with me, and I arrived in Kazan. It was -30 and with wind, And I didn't have any hat, I had no gloves, I had nothing, you know, just like a tourist.
Okay.
And I arrived there, and I remember we were walking to the bus, and I was carrying my stroller, and we walked for like 300-400 meters, and when I arrived at the bus, my hand froze on the stroller, so I had to take my other hand and take each finger like this, you know, to open. Yeah. It was really, really cold, and I had some jeans with me that they were ripped, you know, with holes and so on. So I didn't plan very well. Yeah. And I remember we went to the same Italian restaurant. I ate the same thing. I ate the mozzarella di bufala with parma ham and with tomatoes and rucola. Yeah, and I had what else I had, and I had a pizza every day. So this was same menu every day, same table. We tried it. It was funny.
A very routine.
Yeah.
Magic routine.
Magic routine.
Yes.
Yeah, Marius.
Prego, Luca.
Marius, you come from a big school, the Romanian school of one-handed backhand. There are many examples. Andrei Pavel, that you know very well.
Yes,
then Anescu, Pavel, and also Anescu and Voinea. What's the secret of such talent passed on year by year in your country?
First, Nastase started one-hand back, and Nastase with Tiriac, and then others, Marcus Egarcianu, and all this, and then we came, and after then Pavel, Hanescu, Ungur,
Pescariu,
yeah, Voinea. So we had a lot of players with one-handed back, and I think all the coaches that took us from young age, they started showing us the one-handed backhand, you know, because we were seeing our players from our country having success and playing with one-handed backhand. Then they decided to teach us also. And I look now in juniors with our boys, they all play two-handed backhand, so they don't play the one-handed backhand anymore.
Yeah.
I think it's missing that.
Generally, Italy and Romania have a great and closer connection. What is your personal relationship with Italy, and do you know any words, Italian words?
I mean, I also play league in Napoli. I played last year, and I always come with pleasure to Italy. I played my first final in a challenger. It was in Cremona.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Also, I'm speaking with all the Italians every time when I see them, you know, with all of them, not from Fonini to Bolelli to Berrettini, with all I'm speaking, and whenever I see them, I'm trying to speak Italian to learn more and more, because I can speak a few words and I can understand it, or if I'm going to a restaurant, I can order in Italian, but I'm not 100% speaking well, so I'm trying to exercise.
What's your opinion about Italian young players? You have played with Lorenzo Musetti during the Australian Open. What is the opinion about this guy, and in general of the next gen players?
Man, that was one of my toughest match that I played while losing, you know. It was hurting a lot for me. I was playing not well, and I was up 5-2 in the third, and I was supposed to win, and I thought I had the match, and then suddenly I started to lose focus, and he came back. He just went for the shots, everything went in, and he won the match, but when I left the court, I felt very, very, very bad. You know, I said, look, I don't know if I want to continue playing. It was really, really mentally bad for me. But Italian, I mean, look how many players you guys have right now. So many. You know, Berrettini is young, he's playing good. And then you have Fabio, who were two guys almost in top 10. Probably they were top 10. I don't know if maybe I'm wrong. So, I mean, it's such a great time now for Italian tennis, and for sure they were gonna come up with some more young players, and also Jannik Sinner, he's playing so well.
Yeah,
he's so talented. He's so relaxed when he's playing, and I really like his game. I think he's gonna become very, very successful. And if you see those guys coming up for sure, and with 12, 13, 14, they have an example to follow, and they see that it's possible. And I think you guys have a good program with the Italian Federation, and you have a lot of challengers, futures, ATPs. So I mean, they have this help that they need to become good players, and for sure there's gonna be more guys coming up.
Yeah, and to grow up with our challengers in our country. And Lorenzo, il tuo tour.
Sì, now we can move from Challenger Tour to ATP Tour. 2 years ago, Mirza Basic and you reached the final in Sofia. Mm-hmm. You lost in three sets that final.
Correct.
And you reached that final as an underdog, you know. You
Correct.
And Mirza Basic too. Do you have any regrets about that final?
Yes, I have lots of regrets, because I think for both of us, even for me and for him, it was a good final to have, because we were both, I was ranked around 100, 110 or 105. He was ranked 160, 170. So to play a final in an ATP event against a guy who's 170 or a guy who's 20, you choose for sure the 170. So we both had the opportunity, and I know I had my chances in the first set when I lost the tiebreak. I had good chances to win the first set, and then I won the second. It could be my match, but somehow, you know, in important moments, the whole tournament I play well, but then in the final I started to think a little bit also about my God, it's going to be the first title and so on. So the mental part took me down, and I lost that match. Same thing happened with Roger in the final, you know, because I was up.
Yeah.
I was
a few months later.
Yeah, and I was up.
The final against Roger in Basel.
And the tournament also.
Yes.
Yeah. What about your memories in the final against Roger?
I want to finish first with Sofia. I remember we were playing Davis Cup in Romania in a small country up in northeast in Piatra Neamț, and we finished Sunday. I drove back to Bucharest 5 hours, then I slept at a friend's place because my apartment was not ready yet, so I was just sleeping on the couch. And then the next day I asked a friend of mine to come with me because my coach, he had to stay home for 1-2 days. Then I went with a friend of mine. I played first round against Hasse, and then after I win the first round, my coach came also, and we were just, again, same routine. We went same restaurant, same ordering, same food, and we arrived in a final. It was really nice. I mean, I went super relaxed there because after Davis Cup, you're always a little bit tired. So I went with no expectations there, and I arrived in the final. It was a great week. The one I will remember, because it was the first final of an ATP. And now about the final in Basel, same thing there. I went with my fitness coach and with Andrei Pavel, and we left Stockholm. We were supposed to fly same flight, me, my fitness coach, and Andrei, but the car that drove us from the hotel in Stockholm, Andrei left his bag with the passport in the car, so he couldn't fly with us. So me and my fitness coach, we flew to Basel straight. Then he had to go back to the hotel, take the bag, come back to the airport, find a new flight. So he arrived late that night, and the next day I was playing. It was weird, and then I was practicing well, but in the matches I didn't play well. I remember I lost to Klan in Stockholm, and then in Shanghai I lost to Pospisil 7-6 in the third and last round qualies. before that I lost in Tokyo. I remember I lost to a guy from Belarus. He's top 100 right now.
Gerasimov.
Yes.
Gerasimov.
So I was not full of confidence, but Andre kept telling me, hey, man, just stick with your game and stay there. It's gonna come. But when your coach is saying and you don't win, you start to not believe it. And I just went there. I said, you know what? It's the last two tournaments of the year is Basel, and then I play Bratislava, and that's it. And if I finish top 100, fine. If not, you know what? I'm tired. I just want to relax for 2 weeks and start again. And then the final game after each match, when I went out, I couldn't believe, like, you know, okay, semis now. Oh, final. Wow. Yeah. So it came at the right moment and I was playing well. And it was final, playing first time against Roger in a final of 500 and at his hometown. I mean, it was a dream came true. Oh, of course, I want to play him. I want to play Novak. I want to play Rafa. But I don't want to play them in the first round of a Grand Slam. You know, I want to play them.
Yeah.
If I play them in final, it's the best way.
It's different, yeah.
It's much more different.
We have just talked about your recent results. So I wonder, what is your long-term goal in your career? And if you have a need and dream as a tennis player to realize?
I want to win an ATP.
Okay.
This is a dream for me, at least one ATP. In doubles I have it already, but I want in singles also. I want to be the best I can be, you know, my best Mario Scopil, best ranking. I'm giving 100%. I'm trying to do everything I can to improve. Now my goal is to come back to top 100, but I don't want to stop there. I want to see how far I can go with my tennis career. What will be the ranking at the end of my career? You know,
okay.
This is, and I want to have no regrets. So when I finish, not to look back and say, "Oh my God, you know, I was 56, the best ranking." I remember if I would be more professional, if I would do that different, maybe I could be top 50 or 30 or 40. You never know.
Yeah. To conclude this interview, Marius, can you suggest us some video games for these days?
Man, I'm playing every day Counter-Strike whenever I have time. So it relaxes me. I have memories from when I was a young kid. I was playing a lot, 6-7 hours a day I had a team and we were playing league. But now, after 12 years, my skills are not that great anymore. But I'm trying to come back, and I'm playing with some people who wrote me on Instagram and they say, oh, let's play together. So we play. And
that's time to improve.
Yeah, of course. Now I'm thinking to have a laptop also with me when I'm traveling, and to have a mouse and a keyboard to play whenever we have some free time. Thinking to do that. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Marius. It was a great pleasure for us to see you here on Sportface. Enjoy the rest of the evening and good luck for all.
Thank you very much, guys. And I hope to see you soon. And anytime you guys want to do an interview, I'm here. Just let me
Thank
know.
You.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so
ciao,
much.
Ciao, ragazzi.
Un ringraziamento a Mario Scopil e a Lorenzo Andreoli e a tutti gli amici di Sportface.
Ciao.